What if I spoke of a world just at the edges of your perception? Intangible, ever-present, only visible through the narrow windows in your reality. Those who know its esoteric mechanisms can use its influence, which weaves through the material plane. Tell me, dear listener, have you ever seen something inexplicable? A newly Christian symbol seeming to spread like wildfire till you're seeing its barest threads everywhere you go. Individuals of no perceivable talent or charm somehow rising through the ranks of society. Great turmoil conjured from items of seemingly little consequence. A tapestry which appears to enthrall its audience, entangle them for hours in a labyrinth with no escape. Yet deep within this realm, one may hear just the faintest whispers of an ever-toiling wizard claiming worlds as his own. Restless zest is ever favored, his resolve is yet unwavered, penning precious premonitions with an implement of bone. With this most tragic of the muses, dazzles, frightens, and confuses, sealing terror, thought, and feeling in a single mythic tone. If you dare to follow, nearest viewer, to truly open your eyes, I can show you what he saw.
So, on the day this is uploaded, I will have spent the past year of my life reading Pact by the insanely prolific, intensely inventive, and possibly sadistic Wildbow, who brings his talents to bore once again to give us the story of Blake Thorburn, our resident white sheep of the demon-dealing family, as he realizes that the strange house he just inherited might come with some stipulations, magic destinies, dubious allies, dangerous enemies, and a one-way ticket to the secret magical society that exists beneath the noses of the unawakened. If that particular flavor feels familiar to you, then you're probably one of us. The strange, the powerful, the ones who got in trouble for trying to cast spells at their second grade math teachers. That is to say, you probably grew up reading a whole bunch of urban fantasy too. I was always drawn to the genre, possibly because I grew up in a very magic-looking forest. I knew the world couldn't possibly be as dull or boring as my parents said it was. I mean, come on, one god? How lame is that? And I was diagnosed with cool demigod syndrome.
So now I take Adderall.
And I never really stopped reading them, from Fablehaven to Bartimus and Artemis, and all the way up through much more mature, sophisticated selections such as Hellblazer, Sandman, John Dies at the End, and Fablehaven Dragonwatch, because I can't help it, it's still so good! So halfway through my work on this video, the phenomenally scholarly and frequently fun folks at OSP put out a trope talk on urban fantasy, which I, for one, wholeheartedly recommend, especially if you're new to their channel. They go really in-depth with their examination of the genre, but it all starts with the idea that urban fantasy combines arcane ideas with the familiarity of our world to create a readily accessible fantasy environment. You see, being set in a world much like ours gives them the opportunity for blatant wish fulfillment! If the protagonist is from boring old Earth, then they're a perfect stock character with no personality to damage the careful process of vicariously fucking vampires. Gives them the opportunity to explore historical, anthropological, and sociological ideas. To use that contrast provided by the unfamiliar, the magical, to recontextualize and thus shed light on the things that we do find familiar, our society. The trappings of our concepts, what anthropologists would call habitus, and the things we wouldn't necessarily notice otherwise. Just look at American Gods by Neil Gaiman, a story heavy with themes of colonialism and what happens to gods if you leave them here. His veiled reality is one of new powers, technology, and television which seek to replace the old. In his words,
American Gods is a novel about America, but it's also a novel about immigrants and immigration. It's an immigrant novel because I was an immigrant. I moved to America in 1992 and spent 6 or 7 years looking at the place I was living and trying to understand it.
When gods change as they cross over into this new land, that change reflects in metaphor what America does to the cultures and ideas of the people who've populated it. So when Odin the Allfather, wisest of the Aesir, clever trickster poet, god of leadership and courage, is reduced to the conniving, pathetic con artist that is Mr. Wednesday, it ain't just for shits and giggles. Tolkien can say whatever the fuck he wants about how fantasy should be applicable instead of allegorical, but even ignoring how his treatment of orcs has been applied by his more Islamophobic fans, when your fantasy world is directly engaging with our own, you're going to have to address the cultural phenomena of our world somehow. Part of what I loved so much about Worm, Wildbow's previous work, which you can read here to gain my eternal favor, was its movement from metaphor to magic. The superhero genre of fiction is sprawling, with powers being a way to explore family roles, heritage, code switching, or any number of other issues. But it has at its core the idea of trauma, the trauma of loss, disfigurement, childhood abuse, or bigotry, and how it can push you to a place of heroism or turn you into a terrible monster. Worm took that conceit and expanded it into the literal magic of its universe. So if urban fantasy, when it's not busy being a 500-word essay on why you want to fuck vampires, is similarly concerned with reflecting aspects of a changing society through the idea of a magical otherworld, then Pact gives it the same old wild bow treatment by literalizing that concept and then expanding it out into a universe more comprehensive than American Gods, more explicit and articulate in its address of social issues than Fablehaven or Artemis Fowl, more logically consistent and intentionally constructed than Hellblazer, and more actually good storytelling than the Mortal Instruments. Pact interprets sociological movements and evolving symbology into unique, complex systems of magic that retain the nuance and tough questions of the institutions and ideologies they're supposed to reflect. But it's also doing more than just that, because the magic of Pact is the magic of stories. For you—
Jay?
See? Yeah, what's up? I'm kind of busy over here.
Yeah, sorry. It's just, haven't you already made this video before? Wasn't this the big thesis that put you on the parahumans map, got you invited to All Pact Up, and made certain people force you to read this book in the first place?
Well, yes, but here at the J Maniac Channel we have a brand, dammit, and that brand is the metatextual analysis of magic. It may be specific, but who the hell else is doing it? And besides, in the words of Elliot...
There's a user called J-Maniac who's been making some great YouTube videos recently about how Worm presents itself and integrates narrative devices into the story to make them make sense. And Pact is just completely destroying Worm in that regard. Like, this theory was a great thing for Worm, but I'm reading Pact now and I'm just like, this is doing that, but like 100 times more.
Because instead of narrative functions being fulfilled by the magic system on a meta level that I won't get into because of Worm spoilers, here, not only does the universe incentivize conflict, it also builds specific narrative tropes into the workings of the magic system, and in doing so makes the assertion that these tropes and storytelling shortcomings are a result of the societal structures we're familiar with. Pact constructs an idea of society as the sum of all of the stories we keep telling, and thus sets up a framework by which it can commentate on both. In convincing you to read Pact, I could tell you about the relentless energy of the plot, or how it uses the rules of its world, like magic users can't lie, to create endlessly intricate dialogue and brilliant, unique conflict. I could tell you how each interpretation of a long-revisited fantasy trope has a fascinating twist that makes it all brilliant and new again. I could go on long hypothetical rants that go over all the selling points of the book that I still need to convey to you, but don't particularly fit the thesis of the video I'm trying to make. But my English teacher taught me better than to be that thematically incoherent, so instead let me ask you a question. What is the point of fantasy? Well, sure, it's fun and that's important, but let's do something crazy for a minute here and pretend that genre fiction is capable of conveying powerful thematic magnitude and therefore perfectly worthy of literary criticism. An utterly shocking notion, I'm sure. For the answer, I'll point you to a simple yet elegant and wonderfully articulate quote, which I believe to exemplify a startlingly poignant summation of fantasy's incalculable value in our daily lives.
You are dumb. You are sad. Your brain run by goblin. Pull him out and beat him.
Positively breathtaking. Okay, so it's not much to look at, but believe it or not, this core concept has been a legitimately valuable intellectual tool for me and my friends. Let me translate for you.
You are dumb. You are sad. Your brain run by goblin.
That voice in your head, the one telling you that your friends are just pretending to like you, that your presence only bothers them, that you're never going to be as interesting or intelligent as anyone around you, that voice isn't you. It's a tiny, stupid creature made of intrusive thoughts and shitty CGI. The video also provides a prescription for said ailment.
Pull him out.
Make the thoughts external, voice them and realize them apart from the self, distance them out of your own head.
Out and beat him.
Use whatever linguistic and intellectual tools you and your friends have on hand to kick the metaphorical tiny green ass of the unhealthy mindset. It doesn't belittle our problems. If a year of reading Pact has taught me anything, it's that goblins can be more ferocious and daunting than we ever gave them credit for. Fighting them is hard, even with friends by your side, but we find that knowing what you're fighting is a good place to start. That little exercise, which has since been integrated into our speech and thought patterns, is a microcosm for what fantasy has the power to do: construct better models for thinking about the issues we face in life. While there are less useful or thoughtfully constructed examples...
Dude, what if, like, orcs were black people? Whoa.
Yeah, that's where we stop thinking about it. Pact's perspective is one that I think is valuable to the world moving forwards, as a framework for thinking about society's issues. And the questions it uses its magic to raise are the same questions we'll be forced to think about moving forward. To give an example, this world's take on goblins provides a very different, but equally useful, recontextualization. Pact's goblins are ugliness incarnate, literally. They're beings of pettiness, hatred, disease, mucus, sweat, pimples, and pretty much everything that you don't want to think about. Brutality, genitalia, villains who lick their hostages, whatever just grosses you out, goblins turn it up to 11. Hell, even their names are things you'd call someone if you were pissed the fuck off and feeling creative. They exist mostly to ruin things, vandalize, beat the shit out of people, toss moldy baseballs through windows, topple power lines, run in front of your car, chew through cables, start bushfires, and generally ruin everyone's lives. They aim to frustrate, to turn people against each other, to keep the ugly as possible. Luckily, they're not very smart, and things like soap, cleanliness, pure metal, white picket fences, and signs of civilization tend to repel them. So only one or two really crafty ones can get into somewhere like an office building or school. They have much easier access to places that are already ugly, so those become their typical targets. Now, why is the mindset that that magic creates an important one to hold? Let me put it this way. It is kind of difficult to rationally understand why poor people stay poor. In fact, you could probably take someone's life, get a list of all their resources, and devise a plan to have them out of poverty in a year, using everything society tells you is rational. Problem: you probably forgot about the goblins. Those resources will be ruined by goblins. That savings plan, this lifestyle, impossible around this many goblins. But if you don't know that, and you show that person the plan, and then you check back later only to find that they're in the exact same spot, you're liable to blame them for their poverty. David Wong, of Cracked Magazine and John Dies at the End fame, has this fantastic article called Why We Can't Stop Hating the Poor about this very subject. But if we're thinking in terms of goblins, it'll be potentially easier to devise strategies for dealing with our issues, as well as more obviously problematic to blame impoverished people for their situation. Understanding the story that society tells, and the problems we create by passively reinforcing those narratives again and again and again, is the only way we're going to make our world a better one. You wanted to solve your problems with magic? Well, this is it. I mean, if the universe were actually rational, I'd have had this video up months ago, because I would have been fine after the first time I googled how to not procrastinate everything you love out of existence. I forgot about the fucking goblins. But that's what books like Pact are here to teach us.
That the world you live in is made of ideas, not air, light, atoms, or gravity, but the stories we tell, those we choose to give power, voice, and belief. And learning to influence spirits, to twist the stories around you, that magic will always serve you better than a fist, a gun, or even $1 million. Without fantasy, the illusion of reality could fool you, but with the lens it offers, if you really are one of us, perhaps you too could see the world as it truly is. Beautiful, terribly magical. So why not open the book and find out?
But hey, if it's just a fun story, there are worse things to spend your time on. What have you got to lose? I'm Jay.
And it's oh so good to be back.
Stick around the channel if you want more on Pact, because after a year of applied reading, you'd better believe I've got something to say about it. Maybe I'll be able to squeeze it into less than 6 videos, but that's the current plan, so who the fuck knows? Thank each and every one of you for watching.
And I'll see you on the other side.